Now let's talk about structured light range finding. Our primary objective here is to compute the depth of each point in the scene. And so we'll start with simple methods and build things up. So the simplest way you can do this is called point-based range finding. So in this case, you have a three-dimensional scene right here, and you have a camera, and also a light source, which happens to be a laser pointer, say, for instance. It produces one ray of light. It's not illuminating the entire scene. It's just one ray of light, which is shown by the red line right here. And we're going to assume that the position of this laser pointer and the camera is known with respect to each other. In fact, we'll define the coordinates system of this entire range-finding system to be located at the central projection or pinhole of the camera. That's right here. So we know where the pointer is and how it's oriented with respect to this coordinate frame. So now you shine this ray out into the scene, and it strikes the surface, the scene, at some point. That point is then going to produce a bright radiance, and it gets imaged by the camera to produce a bright point at this location, xi, yi in the camera. So the question is, if I am able to detect xi, yi, the bright point, then can I compute the three-dimensional structure of, or the coordinates of this point right here? And indeed you can, because this point xi, yi gives you the equation, thanks to perspective projection, of the line of sight corresponding to that point. That's this orange ray that's given by these two equations right here. And we already know in this coordinate frame the equation of the straight line that goes out, that corresponds to the light ray that's being emitted by your laser pointer. That's the red ray right here. And that's given by this, these equations right here. So essentially, the point XYZ, the scene point, corresponding to this bright point in the image, lies at the intersection of the scene ray that goes out from the camera and the light ray that goes out from the laser pointer. And so that's very easy to compute. So how does one use this in practice? Well, let's say that you have a scene and the scene has some ambient illumination. It actually looks like this. And now you project this light ray onto the scene. You get a bright point right here. So what you could do is take a picture without the laser pointer, take a picture with the laser pointer, and then you subtract the two to get this image right here. This is a simple technique called background subtraction. So you can do this once. You can have the background image captured once before you start the process. And then for this particular bright point that you see here, you're able to compute the three-dimensional coordinates x, y, z of the corresponding point in the scene. Okay, so the main question that we're concerned with here is how many images would be needed to recover a depth map of the complete scene. So the only way we can do this is actually scan the entire scene, is to move the light ray such that it just covers every point in the scene. Let's take a look at that once again. Just literally scan the entire scene with your laser pointer. But you need to take one image for each location of, or each orientation of your scene ray. So you need one image per pixel, so to speak. If you had an image that you want to compute, a depth map which has 640 by 480 pixels, then for each one of these pixels, you need to capture an image. So that would correspond to, in this case, 300,000 images, which if you're using a camera that captures 30 frames per second, which is usually the case, then that would take you 3 hours to capture all the information you need to compute just this one depth map. Way too long, obviously, for virtually any application. So the question is, can we do a lot better than this? And indeed, we can. So instead of using a laser pointer that throws out one ray of light, imagine that you have some kind of a projector that throws out a plane of light. This is called light striping, the light stripe method. So there's a plane that's being thrown out. this plane of light goes into the scene and will intersect the scene along some curve, and that gets imaged. And now for each point along that curve, we want to be able to find the depth of the corresponding point in the scene. And indeed, that's possible, because what you have now is the equation of a straight line that goes out into the scene from the point x, I, y, I. Let's say that's the point you're concerned with right now. You have a straight line for that. And you have the equation of the light plane as well, which is generating your light stripe. That's your light plane. And we assume for now that everything is known to us with respect to the location of the projector, with respect to the camera, etc. So we know the equation of the light plane in the coordinate frame of the camera. And so this physical point corresponding to this bright point in the image, the physical point, must lie at the intersection of the ray that goes out from the camera and the light plane. And that's very easy to find from these equations that you have right here. And you get a very simple expression for the z component, or the depth of the point in the scene. And once you have depth, z, you can plug it back into these perspective projection equations, and you can get x and y as well. All right, so how much better do we do by using light striping? In other words, how many images do we need? So this is a useful way to look at this scenario. On the right side, you see what the projector sees. Of course, the projector doesn't see anything, but if you are sitting at the projector location, you're throwing out a light plane. So that's going to look like an absolute straight line. That's going to correspond to one column of what we'll call the projector image. Even though the projector doesn't capture an image, it generates an image, and that's what's being projected out into the scene. So that's one column right here. And that light plane goes in, like I said before, and intersects the three-dimensional world to create this curve right here, this profile, cross-section, if you will. This is what the camera sees. So the question is, how many images do we need to take in this case? Well, you need to project one light plane for each column in the projector. And so it's one image that you need to capture for each column of the projector. And so now if you go back to our goal, which is to capture a 640 by 480 depth image, and let's say 640 is the number of columns in your image, then you would still need to capture 640 images, which takes roughly 31 seconds, still way too long. Now, so the question really, the obvious question here is, why do we need to just project one plane into the scene? Why is it that we cannot project multiple stripes at the same time? Why not do this? Simply throw out a bunch of stripes. You're going to get an image with a bunch of intersections. And we should be able to, at least at first glance, it appears that we should be able to take any one of these curves right here and figure out which column here produced that curve. Well, we are able to do this because we're using our visual system to reason through this and figure out which one of these intersections, which one of these curves would have been produced by which one of these columns or stripes right here. But actually, there is no way to really do this in practice, especially for complex scenes. So imagine that this is your scene. You have me in the background, my hand right here, and you have a light plane coming through. This light plane can actually go between my two fingers here and go off and strike something in the background right here. And whereas the next light plane that comes in strikes this finger. So what's going to happen now when you look at it from the perspective of the camera, the order of these light curves that you're talking about, the intersections, can be switched very easily. So there's no obvious way of telling which light plane produced a bright point in the image when you have multiple stripes that you're putting out. So if you're looking at this point right here, in general, it could have been produced by any one of these light stripes. And each one of them corresponds to a different depth in the scene, a different three-dimensional coordinate. So it's ambiguous. So that brings us to binary coded structured light. That is, we started off with point scanning, and then we did better with striping or line scanning. And now we want to do even better in terms of the number of images that we need to capture, make it more efficient. So here's the idea behind binary coded structured light. Very simple idea, which is that imagine that in our example, we're going to use 7 stripes. Of course, in practice, you would use many more, but let's start with the example of 7 stripes. We can give each one of these stripes a number, 1 through 7. And then we can express this in terms of a binary number. So it takes 3 bits, as you know, to express numbers from 1 through 7. 3 bits right here. So you have 001, 010, all the way to 111. So only 3 bits are necessary. That's the important part here. So you're going to write out your bits right here as such. Bit 1 for each stripe, and then bit 2, and then bit 3. So now here's what you're going to do. You're going to look at bit 1, and you then illuminate the scene in such a way that all the stripes for which bit 1 is 0, you keep them off, and all the stripes for which bit 1 is 1, you activate them. So in this particular case, bit 1, you're going to have 4 stripes going out, these 4 stripes. And that's exactly what you see here. You capture an image. And then you do the same thing with bit 2, and you capture an image. In this case, you see this is a 1, this is a 1, 1, 1, and indeed you see these 4 stripes here, these 4 intersections. And you do the same thing with bit 3. So you capture only 3 images. And now, if you consider any point in the scene, let's take this point right here, you see that this point was on, it was bright in the first image, off in the second image, and it was on again in the third image. And the only light stripe that was on in the first image, off in the second image, and on in the third image is number 5. So by just capturing 3 images, you're able to, without loss of information, be able to figure out for each point in the scene which light stripe actually illuminated it. Once you have that, as you know, using the previous method, that's a line scanning method, you can figure out the three-dimensional coordinates of the point. So that's the power of binary coding. But it gets interesting when the numbers get larger. So in general, we can do 2 to the power of n minus 1 stripes using just n images. And the minus 1 that you see right here is only due to the fact that we are not using 0, 0, 0, because 0, 0, 0 corresponds to all the stripes. In our example here of 7 stripes, this corresponds to all the stripes being off. That doesn't really add any information to our system, and hence the minus 1 right here. So you can see here, the 2 to the power of n minus 1 stripes and n images. So if you have 8 images, you want to capture 8 images, you can actually do 2 to the power of 8, that's 256 minus 1, 255 stripes. So that's a reasonable number of images now, especially if you're able to do this using a fast projector and a fast camera. Okay, so let's take a look at an example here. So in this example, this is how you would set up the system. You have a digital projector of some sort, and that's the one that produces your light patterns that you're going to throw out onto the scene. In this case, we are going to use 7 patterns, which means we are willing to capture 7 images. And here are the patterns that you see right here, pattern 1 through pattern 7. You project these 7 patterns onto your scene, which is shown right here, and you capture these 7 images. Now, if you look at any one point here in the image plane, it produces essentially what we might see as a code word. So it happened to be off in the first image, on, off, off, on, and off. But this right here, this code word tells you exactly which column in your projector illuminated. In other words, which stripe illuminated that point. That's all you need to compute the three-dimensional coordinates of that point. So using that technique, for every pixel in the image, you can reconstruct the three-dimensional shape of the object in the scene. Now, there is one subtlety here that's worth looking at, which is errors due to what we might call light bleeding. So let me first explain what we mean by light bleeding. This whole idea of using the structured light in these patterns is really based on the assumption that you have essentially two states at each pixel. The pixel is either lit or it's not lit. But in reality, you can have light bleeding between a pixel and its neighboring pixel. That is, you have a projector. The projector itself has a finite depth of field because, after all, it's using a lens to project. What that means is, for certain points in the scene, the illumination pattern that's being projected might actually be somewhat smoothed or blurred. In addition, the camera that you're using to capture information also has a finite depth of field. So what that means is that during the image capture itself, you might have some blurring of the image, which again produces light bleeding, especially around transition points. That is, when you have a black area next to a white area exactly at that edge, that's the part that we are concerned with. So for example, in the code that we used, the binary patterns that we use in the case of seven stripes, you see that there are actually 10 transitions here. That's the way it works out. Whenever you go from a 0 to 1 or a 1 to 0, that's what we call a transition. At these transitions, the brightness value may be ambiguous in the sense that if you're using some threshold, you might make the error of calling a 1 a 0 or vice versa. And if you do, the errors can be substantial because we're doing all of this in binary. So as many as 10 errors are possible here. So that brings us to the idea of gray coding, which essentially mitigates this. It doesn't resolve this problem completely, but it's reducing the problem substantially by reducing the number of transitions. So here you have your transitions, but you can play a little game by simply swapping the numbers that you assign to these different stripes. We had initially gone from 1 to 7 right here, but let's say that you make the third one 2 and the second one 3. You make the seventh one 4 and the fifth one ends up being 7 and so on. By swapping these numbers, you're basically changing the binary code associated with each number, each one of these numbers, the binary representation changes. In doing so, you reduce the number of transitions to 6 in this particular case. You're not losing any information here, you're just changing the numbers of these stripes, but you are gaining in terms of number of transitions. Okay, so this brings us to the idea of extending this to multiple levels of brightness, say for instance. So we talked about two levels, on or off, and that's your binary coding system. And that means that you know that binary system has base 2, right? But you can go to the ternary system, which has three levels. You might use three levels of brightness. One of them could be off, the second could have some value, and the third one could be double that value. Or you could have three different colors that you're projecting, red, green, and blue. Anyway, there are three levels, and so you have the ternary system, where you have base 3, and in this case, you can hope to actually do even better. And in general, you can go to K levels and do even better, where K is much larger. So you have levels going from 0 to K minus 1. So let's take a look at the ternary system and doing structured light using color coding. So we come back to the same problem we were looking at before, which is we have these 7 stripes right here, right? Numbered 1 through 7. But when you're using the ternary system, which has 3 levels, you express this not using bits, but what are called trits for ternary digits, trits. And you only need 2 trits for each one of these to represent each one of these numbers right here. So in this case, it would be 0, 1, 0, 2, and so on and so forth. And let's say that these three levels we're using, 0, 1, and 2, in our implementation correspond to three different colors, red, green, and blue. So then in that case, this is what the patterns would look like that you're going to be projecting. In the first image, you're going to project red, red, green, 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 and blue, blue, and so on. So this is your first light pattern right here. So again, you take this first pattern and you simply project it onto the scene and you capture an image. And now you take your second pattern, project it onto the scene, capture your second image. And let's go back to our point here, where let's say this, you're looking at this point right here. Well, this point happened to be green in the first image, and then it was blue in the second image. And the only stripe that was green in the first image and blue in the second image is stripe number 5. And so once again, once you know that, you can compute the depth of the point. So we went down from 3 images to 2 images, but that's in the case of 7 stripes. In general, with k levels, let's say you're using k different levels, k different colors or k different brightness values, we get to do k to the power of n stripes in just n images. And when one of these levels, as before, is 0, then we don't want to be using all zeros, that's just doing nothing. And so then in that case, if you're using that as one of the states, then you get k to the power of n minus 1 stripes. So it is a big payoff. Now, talking about color, a couple of caveats that are worth mentioning. So we see here that we can increase the number of colors and therefore get more and more efficient in terms of structured light. But there is a price to pay. So if you're using a regular camera and a regular projector, you know that the colors tend to be broad band in terms of the spectra that they actually put out. And cameras have broad band filters for capturing the color channels as well. So let's say you're using an RGB projector, an RGB camera, and you decide that you wanted to do more than 3 colors, a lot more colors, say these colors right here, it's quite possible that you end up capturing colors in the image that look very similar, very difficult to distinguish. Partly because the colors themselves may actually be very close to each other in terms of spectrum, but also one has to take into consideration the fact that the object that you're reflecting onto, that you're projecting onto, has its own reflectance properties. It may reflect certain wavelengths more than other wavelengths. Those are the spectral properties of each point in the scene. And so these stripes in the image, when you capture them, might end up being too similar to differentiate with respect to each other. And then there is a greater problem of not getting any reflection at all. So let's say you had a deep blue patch in the scene and you're projecting onto it a bright red stripe. Well, we know that blue and red are at two different ends of the spectrum, the visible light spectrum, and therefore the blue patch is unable to reflect any of the red light. And so you don't get any reflection in these areas. That also happens when you have a red patch and you're projecting a blue stripe onto it. So these are some limitations. And what's interesting is that the kind of scene that color coding actually works really well for is a scene that essentially has gray objects. Because we know that a gray point reflects all colors equally well. And therefore, the gray world, so to speak, is ideal for color-coded structured light.